Hello and welcome to Geek Disorder's HTML5, CSS3, JavaScript, and jQuery series. This is Lavik. I'll be walking you through this series. This is video number 2. This is an overview of web development. Okay, we're going to set the basic groundwork so you'll kind of understand what we're doing when we get into more of the HTML5, CSS3, JavaScript, jQuery, stuff like that. Alright, what is a web application? A web application is a collection of clients, web servers, and networks. The client requests information from a web server. This information is normally a web page. The web server retrieves the requested information and returns it to the client. The requesting and returning of this information is done over a network. Now, without any of these three components, you do not have a working web application, most likely. Without a client, your web server and network are just sitting there. Without a web server, well, your client can request all at once, but nothing will ever be returned over the network. And without a network, in most cases, your client and your web server can't connect. Alright, and then we have networks. Well, a network consists of two or more computers that are linked together in order to share resources. There are two basic types of networks. There's a local area network, or called a LAN. A local area network is two or more computers that are linked together and are near each other. This network is often called an intranet. You'd find this in like buildings. A business might own a building and they connect the whole building with a local area network so their employees can exchange information over the local area network. Next, you have a wide area network, or a WAN. A wide area network is two or more local area networks that are connected together. Now, how do local area networks and wide area networks make up the internet? Well, first you have internet exchange points, or IXPs. When many different wide area networks are connected together, the point at which they all connect is an internet exchange point. Okay, then you have internet service providers, or ISPs. A internet service provider is an organization that owns a wide area network and leases access to its network. The wide area network owned by the organization is connected to the internet at one or more IXPs, or internet exchange points. Alright, well, we have, we're going to move into web pages here. That's kind of like the difference between a few different types. We have static web pages. A static web page only changes when the web developer manually changes it. So in order to change a static web page, you would have to go in and edit it yourself. A static web page will most likely have an HTML or HTM file extension. When the client requests a static web page, the web page is sent from the web server directly back to the client. The web server doesn't have to do anything special. This HTML5, CSS3, JavaScript, and jQuery series is going to teach you how to make static web pages. Okay, the process of retrieving a static web page from the web server. Well, the client makes the request for a static web page in most likely a web browser. The request is known as the HTTP request, or Hypertext Transport Protocol request. This HTTP request lets the web server know what file is being requested. The web server retrieves the requested file. Most of the time it's the HTML or a hypertext markup language file, and then returns that file as part of the HTTP response. The client's browser retrieves the HTTP response and translates the HTML file into a web page that is displayed on the client's browser. Okay, next you have dynamic web pages. A dynamic web page is created by a program or script on a web server each time it is requested. A dynamic web page can have many different extensions like PHP, ASPX, JSP, and so on. Okay. A program or script, and this program or script is located on an application server. Okay, so the program or script that is executed is determined by data that is sent from the client along with the HTTP request. Okay, let's go through the process of retrieving a dynamic web page. The client makes an HTTP request for a dynamic web page in the web browser, most likely. The web server retrieves the HTTP request for a dynamic web page. It then looks at the extension of the requested file to find out which application server should process the request and sends the request to that server. The application server retrieves the request and it runs the specified program or script. The program or script often, based on the data that was sent from the client along with the HTTP request, retrieves the appropriate data from a database server. After the application server runs the program or script and retrieves any data it needs, it then processes the information and generates an HTML file and returns it to the web server. The web server then returns the HTML file to the client's web browser as part of an HTTP response. The client's browser receives the HTTP response and translates the HTML file into a web page that is displayed in the client's browser. Okay, HTML and CSS. Hypertext markup language, or HTML, is used to define the structure and content of a web page. Cascading style sheets, or CSS, are used to control how a web page is displayed. It does this by specifying the fonts, colors, spacing, layout, and borders of a web page. To recap, HTML defines the content and structure of the web page. CSS defines the formatting of the content. We separate the content and the structure from the formatting, and this makes it easier to create and maintain your web pages. HTML and CSS continue. Today there are two versions of HTML as of today, July 25th, 2013. We have HTML 4.01 and XHTML 1.1. This is because HTML 5 is not an official standard yet and most likely will become an official standard in 2014. HTML 5.1 standard is already being worked on. When HTML 5 becomes an official standard, it will replace both HTML 4.01 and XHTML 1.1. So why are we learning HTML 5 if it's not a standard yet? Well, because HTML 5 is complete and is in the testing phase, and all modern browsers already support most of the basic features of HTML 5 and CSS 3. Okay, communities. You should know about a couple in the HTML 5 world. You have the World Wide Web Consortium, or W3C. This is an international community that develops web standards. You can check them out at the following link, www.w3.org. Okay, next is the Web Hypertext Application Technology Working Group, or WG. This is a community of people interested in evolving HTML and related technologies. Check them out at www.whatwg.org. Alright, we're going to move on to JavaScript now. JavaScript is a client-side scripting language. It is ran by the JavaScript engine of the web browser and controls the operation of the web browser. When an HTTP response contains JavaScript or JavaScript file is linked to an HTML file, both the HTML and the JavaScript are loaded into the web browser. JavaScript is run on the client's machine, so your personal computer if you're the one requesting the web page, and not on the web server. Because of this, JavaScript provides functions that don't require communication with the web server. This series will cover the introduction to JavaScript and a JavaScript library called jQuery. Alright, server-side scripting languages. A server-side scripting language allows you to develop dynamic web pages. The web pages which change on their own based off of what information is requested. A few server-side scripting languages are ASP.NET, PHP, JSP, Perl, and Ruby. Many server-side scripting languages require a specific web server to run on. The two most popular are Apache and Microsoft's Internet Information Services, or also known as IIS. We will not be covering server-side scripting languages in this tutorial, but in the future we will be making mini series on the different languages listed above. Web browsers. The most popular web browsers are Internet Explorer, Firefox, Chrome, Safari, and Opera. When you develop a web page, you need to test it in all the browsers your audience might use. This includes versions of each browser that are still in common use. So, you know, you want to test the latest edition of Chrome, then you want to go back a few versions to make sure it still works. Same with Internet Explorer, Firefox, Safari, and Opera. Internet Explorer has been known to give headaches, especially if you had to go back to Internet Explorer 6 and such as that, which I would suggest you not do anymore. People are, hopefully, most everyone has moved away from Internet Explorer 6. Those that have, should you go waste a lot of your time based on a very small percentage? I would say no, but that is up to you. Okay, well, thank you for watching this video. This is video number 2. Next, we'll be getting into what tools you'll need in order to complete this series. All right, well, I'm Lavik, and thank you for watching the HTML5, CSS3, JavaScript, and jQuery video number 2. Y'all have a good day.